I built this super cool machine learning model that predicts whether you will die in a car crash the next time you get behind the wheel. The good news is the model is 99.99% accurate. That is pretty good. The bad news, however, is that this is what my model looks like. Alright, so listen, I looked it up online and the chances of you dying the next time you drive are significantly lower than 1%. So yeah, my dumb model is pretty accurate. Of course, that model still useless. This car crash situation is an example of an imbalance problem. That happens whenever you have one class that represents the overwhelming majority of the samples in your dataset. If you wanted to identify the legitimacy of credit card transactions, the overwhelming minority will be fraudulent, or the number of patients that are sick with a very rare disease. All of those are examples of imbalance problems. Whenever you're working on one of those problems, you should not use accuracy to measure how good a machine learning model is. And that's insight number one of this video. Many times when we build a model, we care about specific outcomes. We call them positive samples. There is one metric that we can use that will let us know how good a specific model is identifying these positive samples. We call it recall. So let's say we have 100 transactions and 10 of them are fraudulent. If our model is capable of identifying one out of those 10 transactions, the recall of our model will be 10%. If our model can identify 5 out of 10 transactions, the recall of the model will be 50%. The more fraudulent transactions our model identifies, the higher the recall will be. And that's the second insight of this video. Whatever we do, we want to maximize the recall of our model, right? Well, yes, but that's not enough. Imagine that I take my dumb model and I make a small change to it. And my new model looks like this. So now, every single credit card transaction, my model will mark as fraudulent. So that will obviously detect all 10 fraudulent transactions of my data set, and my recall will be 100%. And like before, my model will be completely useless. We obviously need something else. Accuracy is not a good metric. Recall alone is also not a good metric. It's not enough to measure how good my model is. We need something that has a better precision. And precision is precisely the second metric that we need together with recall. Let's make the assumption that now the model will predict that 2 of these 100 transactions are fraudulent. Let's choose these 2 transactions right here. One of them is a fraudulent transaction and the other one is a mistake. The other one is a legitimate transaction. Now, in this case, we already know that the model's recall is 10% because the model is returning 1 out of 10 fraudulent transactions. The precision, however, is 50% because the model is correctly detecting 1 fraudulent transaction out of the 2 prediction that it's making. So, third insight of this video, really quick. If we say that every single transaction is not fraudulent, the recall will be 0, which is a very, very bad model. If we say the opposite and we mark every single transaction as fraudulent, then the precision will be really low, even though the recall will be 100%. So we need to find a balance. We need a combination of these 2 metrics in order to find a good performing model. Something very important to understand is that there is a constant trade-off between precision and recall. Whatever you do to maximize the precision of your model will affect the recall. The opposite is also true. So we need to take a look at the use case we're working on and decide what is the proper balance between precision and recall. Which of the two is gonna be more important for that particular problem? Let me show you the results of a hypothetical model and how you can compute the precision and recall of it. So this is a hypothetical model that I put together here. Now, you'll see the red chips are my positive samples and the blue chips are my negative samples. Now, the results of the model is what you get inside the black square in the middle. Those are the predictions that my model is making as positive samples. In this case, you'll see the true positive samples. Those are problematic samples that my model correctly predicted as positive, and that's why we call them true positives. These four blue chips here, however, those are mistakes that the model made, and therefore we can classify them as false positive. Now here you get the false negatives, and it's because my model did not identify them as positive. And finally, you get the true negative samples. These are samples that my model did not identify as positive, and that was correct. Therefore, they are true negatives. Whenever you have this table, you have everything you need to compute the precision and recall of your model. In this case, the precision is the true positives divided by the sum of the true positives and the false positives. The recall is a little bit different. It's gonna be the true positives divided by the sum of the true positives and the false negatives. Let's go back to the balance that you need between precision and recall. You do not need to worry about two separate metrics all the time. There is one metric that will encapsulate that balance and will let you focus on that metric alone. We call this metric the F1 score. Finally, inside of this video and start wrapping things up. Any model that emphasizes a single metric over the other one is not gonna have a good F1 score value. Keep in mind that the F1 score is a version of the more general F beta score. You can use the F beta score to adjust the weight of the precision and recall. You can adjust that balance. So I cover a ton of ground, but let me close this video with three fundamental key ideas. First, accuracy, not a good metric if you're working with an imbalance problem. Don't use it to measure the performance of your model. Second, look into precision and recall, or a combination of both. Specifically, look into the F1 score metric in order to optimize your machine learning model. Finally, I show you a way to compute the precision and recall, but now I want you to watch this video here that will show you how to create a confusion matrix whenever you're working on a classification model. That is key in order for you to come up with the values that you need to compute the precision and recall of a model. That's it. I will see you in the next one.